Exam one next class period. Bright and early. Well, maybe not so bright, right? Is it, does the sun rise by 7:20? Maybe approximately. So we'll start early. Give an hour and a half for it. In real analysis, there's a big focus on writing out definitions and theorem statements, and because of that in real analysis, I make it closed book, closed notes. But here, that's not really the focus of it. So at least on this first exam, I'm going to make it so you can use a note card front and back, and maybe even your calculator. You can bring in use perhaps calculations. The focus is more on calculations in here, geometric interpretations, and maybe a couple proofs. Okay? Proofs is not going to be a big point of emphasis for us, like I said, but there are proofs sometimes, as we've been doing recently. And so you should be able to do the kinds of proofs that I mentioned, for example, showing that the open right half plane, where the real part of z is positive, be able to show that's open, is one example of a proof you should be able to do. Another example would be showing z squared is continuous at some point that I pick, by showing that its limit as z approaches the given point equals the function value there with an epsilon delta argument. Though if I did put something like that on the test, I'd give you a little help as far as the necessary factoring that would have to happen to help you finish the proof, because that was a little tricky. You did need to make it without loss of generality in that proof. Assume that z was within one unit of the given point. And so then when you chose your delta, you chose it to be the minimum of one and something involving epsilon. So make sure if you don't remember how I did that proof, that you go back and watch that part of that video. All right, you may have noticed on the exam from 4 years ago, the last time I taught this course, that I had a double integral problem on the first exam. Could there be a double integral problem on your exam? Yeah, I think so. Got to make it one that's not too hard to do, though. It's based on this theorem here. Actually, let's catch that front light again. Here we go. Thanks. Got a complex mapping, which we can think of as a real planar mapping. So F is the complex mapping, capital T is the real corresponding real planar mapping. Think of it either way. The goal is to find the area of the image of some set, some region. S is some region, maybe a square, maybe a rectangle, maybe a disk. And you're looking at the image of it. If U and V are continuous, you can find the area of the image. Remember, F of S represents the image. Let me just draw it as a blob here. So here's S. There's the image, F of S, under F. We want to find the area of the image. I hope you remember from multivariable calculus that you can find the area of a nice region like this by doing a double integral of the constant function 1 over the region. This would be the plane here. This would be the xy plane. And it turns out by the change of variables formula in multivariable calculus, you can pull that integral back, so to speak, to the original domain, S. You can integrate the function 1 times the absolute value of the Jacobian determinant of the mapping. Jack of capital phi I'm using to represent the Jacobian determinant. I'm going to call the Jacobian just the matrix, and I'll typically just call that J. This matrix right here. And Jack I'll reserve for its determinant. Sometimes when people use the word Jacobian, they mean the matrix. Sometimes they mean the determinant of that matrix. I will try to make it explicit. There's the Jacobian matrix, there's the Jacobian determinant. The determinant of this thing, take its absolute value and integrate over the original domain, and that is going to give you the area of the image by the change of variables formula. All right, let's see how this plays out in an example. So my function here is z squared plus 4z plus I. Stuck a complex number in there for good magic measure. What are the real and imaginary parts of that? There they are. Let's go ahead and look at what the image looks like of the unit disk. So there is the unit disk. That's S. Now I increase the lambda slider to 1, and we see its image. I'm wondering what the area of the image is. Well, what is the Jacobian determinant in this situation? Let's go back up to these equations here. Those are U and V. So the Jacobian matrix is going to be upper left corner is the partial of U with respect to X, 4 plus 2X. Upper right is the derivative of U with respect to Y, negative 2Y. Lower left is the partial of V with respect to X, 2y. And lower right is the partial of V with respect to Y, 4 plus 2x. Interesting kind of symmetry going on here, isn't there? Taking the form A, negative V, B, A, just like we've seen before. We're not going to evaluate this at some point. We are going to find its determinant. Call that Jack. Remember, quote unquote, absolute value signs of a matrix really being determinant of a matrix, which is not necessarily positive. Not necessarily a positive quantity, though it is in this case. It's 4 plus 2x quantity squared minus 2y times negative 2y, which is going to be plus 2y quantity squared. Expand this out, we'll get 16 plus 16x plus 4x squared plus 4y squared, it looks like. Which is not negative, so we don't have to worry about the absolute value signs. We got to integrate this thing over what? Over the original domain, S, the unit disk in this case, to find the area of the image. That's what the change of variables formula says. Let's make a guess as to the area. This is certainly not in a disk, but maybe it's sort of a pseudo-disk, approximately a disk. Center maybe right about there. Our radius maybe about, 4 or 5. Pi r squared. Somewhere between 16 pi and 25 pi for the area. Perhaps, and pi being about 3.14, we're going to get an area somewhere between 50 and 80 or so units. Let's see what happens. I'm not going to take the time to do it by hand, because we've got a lot of other things to do today. Could you do this integral by hand of this function over the unit disk? Yes, it's not too hard, though you'd want to use polar coordinates. We're trying to integrate this thing over the unit disk in the xy plane. Use polar coordinates, let r go between 0 and 1 and theta go between 0 and 2 pi. And don't forget that the polar coordinates dA is r dr d theta. You have to add an extra factor of r. You remember doing that? Was that a long time ago? 2-3 years ago? What will the integral look like? What will the function look like? Let's see here. So we're going to have double integral. Outer integral, let's say, for theta going from 0 to 2 pi. Inner integral for r going from 0 to 1. The Jacobian determinant, replace. Also, don't forget to replace x with r cos theta. And y with r sine theta. Sixteen plus 16x is going to be 16r times cos theta. Something nice happens here. If x is r cos theta and y is r sine theta, you're going to get a cos squared theta plus sine squared theta involved. 4x squared plus 4y squared is going to simplify to just 4r squared. Don't forget your extra factor of r. Looks to me like this is the integral to do. I haven't made a mistake. And the 4x squared plus 4y squared simplifies to 4r squared. Don't forget the extra factor of r. Would this be that hard to do by hand? Not too bad. First integrate with respect to r. You know, here, multiply the r through, you get a 16r there. Integrate that, you get 8r squared. Here you get 16r squared cos theta. Integrate with respect to r, you're going to get a 16 thirds r cubed cos theta. Here you get another r, you get 4r cubed. Integrate it, you get what? R to the fourth. You're evaluating r from 0 to 1, it wouldn't be too bad. And then you integrate with respect to theta. The only thing involving theta is the cos theta. Integrate cosine, you're going to get sine. It would be harder if this was like a cos squared. You need some trig identity. Probably I'd give that to you. It's not too bad as far as double integrals go. You should be able to finish that in a couple minutes. 18 pi is the answer. I guess between what, 16 pi and 25 pi? So I guess my guess was pretty good. Between 50 and what did I say? 80 or so, 56.5 for the area. Okay. So it's worth practicing a few of those. I might put that on the test. And probably like I did in the exam 4 years ago, I'd give you extra instructions to remind you about this equation, for example. Actually, when we use this equation in multivariable calculus, the roles of x and y versus u and v switch around typically. Usually we think of this as the uv plane and this as the xy plane. Usually we're trying to integrate over the image to begin with, and we pull it back to an integral over some uv plane is the typical way it's done in multivariable calculus. But that's not. You can certainly switch around the roles of the variables, excuse me. All right, back to differentiability and analyticity. What we call complex analysis, another phrase you could say to describe it, is it's the theory of analytic functions. From this point on, almost everything we deal with is analytic functions. What does it mean for a function to be analytic, and what are the consequences of that? That's really what complex analysis is about. It's related to differentiability. Remember, it's related to it in the following way. F is going to be analytic at a point if it's differentiable for all points in some neighborhood at that point. And when it is differentiable for all points in some neighborhood or some open set, then we say it's analytic on that neighborhood or analytic on that open set. I did mention that you should make sure you study the books. Verification that the conjugate function is not differentiable anywhere, even though it's a simple function, and even though the corresponding real planar mapping can be linearly approximated with a real planar derivative, so to speak, it's not differentiable in the complex sense. Differentiable in the complex sense is more restrictive. There are fewer functions, so to speak, that are differentiable, even though we're talking about infinite classes of functions. That vague statement is still what you might call somewhat true. I also mentioned that this function, f of z is the modulus of z squared, it fails to be differentiable at it except for one point. And I was saying, oh yeah, it's in the reading. Well, okay, not really in the reading. It's an exercise. It's number 10 on page 71. What are its real and imaginary parts? A it equals x squared plus y squared, right, without a square root. And there's no I in there. Yeah, the output of this function is always a real number. This is u, and v is the zero function. And you could think of this as getting into the book's discussion about this admissibility versus inadmissibility, that we're not really sort of naturally getting a complex valued function of z here. You don't really have to understand completely what the author means by admissible versus inadmissible, but the author is just trying to give you some intuition. How can we prove that this is not complex differentiable except at the origin? Well, let's focus on the difference quotients. And let me not bother writing limit signs, though if you were going to calculate this out in the test, you should include limit signs, or at least do the calculations I'm going to do and then give a description of what to do at the end. Consider your standard difference quotient. In this context, what is it equal? It equals the modulus of z plus delta z quantity squared minus the modulus of z squared over delta z. And at first glance, that looks really difficult to deal with. How do we deal with this? How do we show the limit of this does not exist if z is not zero? If you're not real familiar with a lot of arithmetic facts in complex analysis, you won't really know what to do here. But if you remember my cleanup of chapter one, that I focused on some facts to remember, just like that. They are often useful. One of them is really useful here. Anytime you've got the square of a modulus of a complex number, that's the same as the complex number times its conjugate. We've got a square of a modulus here. That's the same as the complex number z plus delta z times its conjugate, z plus delta z bar. Same with this one. Square of the modulus of z is the same as z times z bar. It's good to remember that. Oftentimes, whenever you see an expression like this, that's the thing you're going to want to do. We use another one of those properties. Next, the modulus of a sum is the sum of the moduli. I can bring that bar operation down into the binomial here. Like that. And once I've done that, that's going to allow me to actually FOIL now, multiply those two things. Do we see this? We're good? I can now FOIL that. Let's see what happens when we do it. At z times z bar, first times first, outside times outside will be plus z times delta z bar, looking here, plus inside times inside is z bar times delta z, and then I have delta z times delta z bar, you can do it either way, but do it the way I said it, delta z times delta z bar, and then minus z times z bar over delta z. We do get some nice simplification here. The z times z bars cancel. There's not a factor of delta z that can be factored out of everything on top, but it can be sort of partially factored out, and maybe that's helpful. This, factor it out of those two terms. Like that. And then I could break this fraction apart into two pieces. It's not clear that it's necessarily helpful, but let me do it anyway. The second piece, the delta z's, are going to cancel. Now, Now what I'm wondering with this, again, is if z is non-zero, does this have a limit as delta z goes to zero? If z is non-zero, we'll also think about what happens when it is zero. What happens as delta z goes to zero? Well, this part goes to zero. If delta z goes to zero, so does its conjugate. This part stays at z bar. The key thing is what happens to this thing. Does it approach a limit? And the answer is no. And that's the problem for differentiability. If you let, because you've got to let delta z approach zero from any direction. Including along either the real or imaginary axis. If you're approaching zero along the real axis, delta z bar is delta z. It's a real number. By the way, that's another quick fact you should know. Real numbers have the property that their conjugate is themselves. And vice versa, if the conjugate of the complex number is itself, then it's a real number. Another fact you should know, just like that, whenever you might need it. Did you catch what I said there? If this is true, delta z must be real, and vice versa, if delta z is real, this is true. And if that happens, then this fraction is going to simplify to 1. On the other hand, if delta z approaches along the imaginary axis, then its conjugate is its opposite. If delta z happens to be right there, its conjugate's going to be down here. Which means this fraction would simplify to negative 1 when delta z is not 0. And so that's enough of the justification. What I've circled here has no limit as delta z goes to 0. Because we found two directions that delta z can approach zero from where the limiting value is different in both directions. On the other hand, if z itself is zero, then this thing goes to zero because that's always zero right there as delta z goes to zero. And the answer for the derivative of the function at zero would be equal to zero, because this would go to zero and this would be zero. Everything is going to be zero. So it would be differentiable at zero, and its derivative at zero would be zero. But it's not going to be differentiable anywhere else. Is it analytic at zero? No, because it's not differentiable on a neighborhood of zero. It's differentiable just at one point. Understand the subtle distinctions between these concepts. Okay, so I didn't write out a ton of words there, I said a lot. Maybe you want to rewatch this part of the video just in case you want to write those things down. What are we, about 25 minutes into the lecture or so. I did mention you should for the test. I am partially reviewing for the test here, by the way, in these things that I'm saying. I did mention you should be able to use the limit definition of the derivative to find derivatives and verify each equality with brief reasons, like algebra, definition of the derivative. There's the key reason about the definition of a limit not depending on what the function does at the limiting point, whether it's even defined or not. And then there was the continuity fact, the fact that you can find the final limit at the end by plugging in the number based on the continuity of the function. We did what in here? Z squared, 1 over z, z cubed. Maybe I put z to the fourth in the test. Maybe I put 1 over z squared. You should be able to use the limit definition of the derivative for those examples. That might be something to notice. And you've got the note card front and back, so you could put things on note cards too, although you gotta choose what to put on note cards. based on what you feel like your weakest line. There's one new topic that I want to put on the test. It's called the Cauchy Riemann equations. It's the main topic of section 2.4. You're not going to have to do any proofs related to this section. I would encourage you to study the book's proofs. I think for sake of time, we may not have time to go over either of them, including the simpler one. We'll see here. Let me try to geometrically motivate the Cauchy Riemann equations by making some observations about some functions. I think I'll put that up at the top here. So let's pick our favorite function so far, z squared, first of all. And let's look at its real and imaginary parts. I again have entered my capital R, capital E, and capital I, capital M functions here. So I can see the real and imaginary parts by doing this. Be nice if mathematics was programmed to do something like this without having to define these functions. I haven't found anything that does it nicely except by combining complex expand with our little e and I little m. All right, there's our favorite real and imaginary parts. Let's now, instead of focusing on the mapping, let's focus on graphs of the real and imaginary parts themselves. We've done that before. We did that at least one day where we looked at ordinary graphs, I call them, related to the complex function. Let's graph u and v themselves. Let's make contour maps for them. Now, I can certainly do that separately. Let me make a grid to help me do that separately. But now I'm also going to put them together in one picture. So I don't know if you recall, a grid will put things in a grid. It'll put the output in a grid. Use this kind of syntax. There we go. So this is the contour map of x squared minus y squared. This is the contour map of 2x times y. They are kind of similar to each other. Seems like the second one might be like some sort of rotation of the first one. If you put the cursor over these things, yeah, you can see the output values. Well, these contours themselves are not exact rotations of the contours over here. So we have to be careful. It's not completely obvious that they might be rotations of each other. How about if we put them in the same picture? Although if we're going to see the contours for both of them in the same picture, probably the shading needs to go away. And maybe we need to color the contours as well. So let's see here. We're going to use show this time. Show will put them in one picture instead of two separate pictures. Yeah, if I just try to do this, it's probably not ideal. It probably just shows the second one, because the second one's going to overlay the first one. So yeah, that's not ideal. But let me do contour shading, which is an option here. Arrow false in both of these. Then they're both put on top of each other. It might be nice to color them differently. Contour style for coloring. And I think we actually have to use double curly braces here. I tested this out before class and you have to use it. Shade one of them red, one of them blue. Something a little funny seems to be going on near the origin here. That's just because it's not plotting quite enough points. At least with the red one. If I plot more points, it'll get rid of that. Yeah, it'll make it better. So the red level curves are the ones for x squared minus y squared. And the blue ones are level curves for 2x times y. They seem to be related, maybe not only in some sort of rotation, but they're also intersecting each other at right angles. Except at the origin. Everywhere else, they seem to be intersecting each other at right angles. What would that mean? Well, it is related to these Cauchy Riemann equations. The book discusses the Cauchy-Riemann equations in the context of two theorems, two separate theorems. One of them much easier to prove than the other. Let's focus on the first one. Let me go ahead and abuse notation a little bit there. Z is x plus iy. If this function is differentiable at the point z0 equals x0 plus iy0, not saying analytic, just differentiable, and so it's not necessarily differentiable on a neighborhood of the point, then the Cauchy-Riemann equations must be true at this point. What are the Cauchy-Riemann equations? The partial of u with respect to x at the point turns out to equal the partial of v with respect to y at the point. And the partial of u with respect to y at the point equals the opposite of the partial of v with respect to x at the point. This says that these are called the Cauchy-Riemann equations. Yes, Cauchy, not Cauchy. People played a little joke on me in the fall. I'll have to bring it maybe next Wednesday. Cauchy-Riemann equations. Don't say Riemann either, it's Riemann. This there are a necessary condition for differentiability at the point. What does that mean? It means that the function is differentiable at the point. These equations necessarily follow. It turns out they're also a sufficient condition for differentiability at the point if you assume the partial derivatives not only exist at the given point but are continuous on some neighborhood of the point. We'll just focus on the necessity here today. But how would you interpret what these equations mean with the picture? Think in terms of gradient vectors for u and v. The gradient of u, remember gradients? Multi-derivative calculus. I'll use our vector notation with the pointy brackets here. That's the gradient. It's a vector whose first component is the partial of u with respect to x, and whose second component is the partial of u with respect to y. And the gradient of v is going to be similar. What would happen if we take the dot product of these two things? You should remember that gradient vectors, for example, for u, the red one, at a given point are always normal, orthogonal, perpendicular to the curve at that point. Those three words all mean the same thing. Normal, orthogonal, perpendicular. And perpendicular is the geometric word. Orthogonal is the linear algebra word. And normal is the physics word. To all mean perpendicular. Say at this given point right here,
And let's see, the function did increase this way, but the gradient vector for the red curve there is going to look about like this.
Maybe a lot longer, maybe shorter, I'm not sure.
For the blue curve, at the same point, the gradient vector is going to be orthogonal to it. Right angle here. There's the gradient of U at that point, here's the gradient of V. Right angle, this dot product that I didn't write down before, must be zero. And the Cauchy Riemann equations are going to guarantee that. Because you can replace Vx with negative Uy, and you can replace Vy with Ux. Take that dot product, you get negative UxUy plus UxUy, which is identically zero, or which equals zero at this given point. And if these functions exist in a continuous, say, on some open set, then it would be identically zero. By identically zero, I mean always zero. Maybe I'll just write equals zero here. So evidently this orthogonality property, these are called orthogonal trajectories sometimes, must work for even more complicated differentiable functions. Let's try making a more complicated one. Oh, how about z to the fifth plus 4z to the fourth minus 5z cubed plus 2z minus 3. Polynomial. It's going to be analytic everywhere, which is called, what is analytic everywhere? Entire. That is the word people use. It's an entire function. Kind of strange, but it's reality. People use that word. Yikes. There are the real and imaginary parts. Okay, let's make this same kind of contour map. Except we'll copy and paste these crazy looking real and imaginary parts. Do we still see the orthogonality property of the level curves?
Yeah. Functions are increasing really rapidly as you head off up here and over here, so the level curves get really close together. But they are orthogonal, except possibly at points where the gradient is zero, with the other example that occurred at the origin. The gradient vectors were zero, and so we didn't get orthogonality with the level curves there. But for the most part, as far as we can tell here, we're getting orthogonality of these level curves. How about, what about for e to the z? I hope you remember what the real and imaginary parts of e to the z are without thinking about it very much. E to the x times cosine y for the real part, and e to the x times sine y for the imaginary part. There we go. ignore these squiggles, that's probably numerical error. These should be straight lines there. Seems to be happening still. Crossing each other in a perpendicular or orthogonal or normal kind of way. That's the geometric representation of the Cauchy-Riemann equations. Let's do one more thing here. Let's take these real imaginary parts up here and let's check the equations themselves by taking derivatives. The derivative of u with respect to x, the derivative of u with respect to y, the derivative of v with respect to x and v with respect to y, copy and paste the formula for v in these things. And maybe I should switch around the order of the x and the y when I do it for v here, so we see the matching more easily. And maybe I should also put a negative sign in front of the one, the last one here. So what should we see? We should see the first one equaling the third one, and the second one equaling the fourth one.
That's verification of that.
First one equaling the third one, second one equaling the fourth one, when you have the negative sign there in the fourth one.
There's
algebraic verification of the Cauchy Riemann equations for that example. Do they work for E to the Z? Yeah, you should check that they work for E to the Z. It's not too hard. That's something you should check. So as far as the exam goes and the Cauchy Riemann equations go, you know, they should be on your note card if you are afraid you're going to forget them. And they are somewhat easy to forget. You know, you might forget which one the negative sign goes on. And you should be able to verify it for an example. I ask you to verify it. Just the basics. No proofs for the Cauchy Riemann equation. Here's something interesting. What about for sine z? Turns out if you write sine z in terms of real and imaginary parts, you get a hyperbolic function. That's a topic for chapter 3 to see why that works. Cauchy and sine, where cauchy of y is this and sine of y is that. This formula should look somewhat familiar. You remember that cosine of z, well, cosine of theta, pretending theta is a real number, was e to the I theta plus e to the negative I theta over 2. And sine theta was e to the I theta minus e to the negative I theta over 2i. Don't think I put these on the exam from 4 years ago, but they could show up on your exam. You might need to use them to help you do an integral, for example, derive a trig identity, like we did in class. Those equations look kind of similar to these, don't they? Except there's no i's in these equations. By the way, these equations work even if theta is not real, even if it's complex and unreal. And these equations work even if y is not real. Although this real and imaginary part distinction, I'm assuming x and y are real. Here's another way to view the Cauchy Riemann equations. In terms of local linearity and approximating partial derivatives geometrically. So let's see, the upper left graph is the contour map of the real part of sine. Real part of the sine function. And this graph is the contour map of the imaginary part. See a locator cursor there. That's the point I'm looking at in both spots. If I move the cursor over here, it moves elsewhere as well. And no matter where I move it, if I zoom in on those points and think about the zoomed in pictures, these arrows are supposed to represent helping you estimate the partial derivative of u with respect to x and with respect to y. And the opposite of the partial derivative of v with respect to x, that green arrow is pointing leftward because of the negative sign there, and the partial of E with respect to Y. And the idea is you're supposed to see from the picture that it should seem approximately, by imagining estimating partial derivatives as rates of change in the X and Y directions, that those equations are true. This is no proof, but it's hopefully reasonable. I mean, if you think about increasing X by a small amount, see, I don't know if I made these like 0.1 units long. It looks like I made them shorter than 0.1. There's a 1.1 down there. There's a 1.2. It looks like I made these about 0.05 units long or something. If I increase X by 0.05, how much does Y go, or how much does U increase by? You can try to estimate it. The value of U along this level curve is 2.2, and the value along this level curve is 2.4. The value right here might be about 2.3. And it might increase by, well, not quite 0.1. And you can estimate delta U over delta X based on that. Maybe approximately, I'm just ballpark guessing here, 0.08 divided by 0.05 or so. 1.6 or so. The partial of V with respect to Y should be about the same thing. The level curves could be labeled differently. This one's 1 and this one's 1.2. But once again, maybe the value of V goes up by about 0.8 as Y goes up by about 0.05. Right there. And you get the same kind of estimate for delta V over delta Y. Okay? Not a proof by any means, but this kind of estimate is going to work no matter where you are. I could be somewhere else. And those partial derivatives should be estimated to be approximately equal, and in fact they are equal. This is differentiable everywhere. It's analytic everywhere. It's entire. So I have been reviewing for exam one along the way here, as we've gone here today. Of course, there's everything else from chapter one. So I wanted to talk a little bit more about linear approximation and differentiability in relation to something especially called the amplitwist terminology. Tristan Needham wrote the book Visual Complex Analysis that I brought to class a few days. I think I'm going to skip that for today. You could open this up. I haven't put it on Moodle yet, but I'll do so after class. You could run this code and maybe look up the word amplitwist, Google it, and see what you find if you're interested. We will talk about it more next week after the test. For our remaining 5 to 10 minutes here, let's talk about what else to know for exam one. That's everything else from chapter one. I mentioned the chapter two thing so far today. I mentioned the proofs, possibilities, differentiability, analyticity, Cauchy Riemann equations. The beginning of chapter two is all about mappings, which we've done pretty much every day. Section 2.1 is about mappings. What else from chapter one should you know? Well, of course, there's the basic arithmetic. Certainly you should be able to multiply and divide complex numbers and put them in standard form. Standard rectangular form. By rectangular I mean rectangular coordinates, A plus IB. Get answers in. What else? There is the stuff about the point interpretation, rectangular coordinates, and vector interpretations of complex numbers. The basic facts that I said to know quickly related to conjugation and the equations relating the real and imaginary parts to conjugates. Do you remember those? Call those quick recall facts. to use whenever you need them, like the fact that z1 plus z2 bar is z1 bar plus z2 bar, like the fact that the square of the modulus of a complex number is z times its complex conjugate, like the fact that the real part of a complex number is z plus z bar over 2, and the imaginary part is z minus z bar over 2i. There's more that I have not written here, related to modulus, related to those things and their relationships. Again, there's the vector interpretation, there's the triangle inequality. I guess I should say there's the parallelogram law as well, or vector addition. I'll abbreviate triangle inequality like usual. Abbreviation for triangle inequality. There is the really, really important geometric interpretation of multiplication and division. Division like that, even though we hardly ever do. And related to that, there's the polar form. Originally in terms of the cis function, but now we hardly ever use that. We use the exponential function. And there's Euler's identity. And the relationships between these things, that, you know, essentially the most important being that if you multiply two complex numbers of this that are in polar form, just like the symbolic representations would suggest, you multiply their moduli and you add their arguments. And division is just the inverse operation of multiplication, so essentially the same kind of thing holds with that too. When you divide two complex numbers, you divide their moduli, assuming you're not dividing by zero, and you subtract their arguments. And when I say arguments, it could be any argument. It could be interpreted as any argument, although you should know the difference between any old argument and the principal value always being between negative pi and positive pi, including positive pi, but not including negative pi. Be able to translate between rectangular and polar. Be able to use polar to calculate powers more quickly. On the exam from 4 years ago, there was a problem where I said, like, calculate the 101st power or something. Right? You want to use the polar form to do that, and when you use the polar form, it's pretty easy. As long as the numbers are fairly nice, like the modulus of the number being 1, for example, makes the problem a lot easier. The angle being a special angle can make the problem easier, at least if you're trying to get, you know, ultimately take the cosine and sine of those angles to get it back in rectangular form. What else? There are, again, things that I just erased, the cosine theta and sine theta, to use to derive trig identities and to do integrals. And those roots. Now, a couple lectures ago, I went into detail about the roots, the general formula. You know, the general formula for the roots is maybe not as important as understanding the idea of it and how to re-derive it if you had to. In a particular instance. For example, if you wanted to find all the eighth roots of negative 256, now I probably wouldn't give you this because that's just too many eighth roots. But you'd want to represent this in polar form. And it would be helpful to recognize that 256 is 2 to the 8th. I made it easy on myself. 2 to the 8th, e to the negative I pi would be a polar form of that. 1/8 root you'd get by taking the 8th root of 2 to the 8th and, well, okay. I think I do a positive I pi root, so the negative I pi. And dividing this angle pi, this argument, by 8. And, well, pi over 8 is not a readily known angle that you can take the cosine sine of to get an exact form. It might be. It's not something people typically memorize. In fact, I think it probably is. You know, I could tell you what it is on the test. Cosine of pi over 8. Okay, Mathematica is not giving us an exact formula. I think it probably should, since pi over 8 is pi over 4 divided by 2. I don't know if something like this would work. No. Okay, well, I give you something perhaps where the cosine and sine are more easily identified as far as what the exact value is, like cosine of pi over 3 is, what, 1/2? Sine of pi over 3 is square root of 3 over 2, that kind of thing. That would be 1/8 roots, 8th root of negative 256. The other 8th roots would all be found by adding multiples of 2 pi divided by 8, which is pi over 4, to that angle. 2 pi meaning going all the way around. You know you're going to have 8 eighth roots that are equally spaced in the angle. So if you take 2 pi divided by 8 to get pi over 4, you'd want to keep adding integer multiples of 2 pi to this, or integer multiples of this, to pi over 8 to get the other angles. For example, the next one would be 8, which can be simplified by getting a common denominator of 8 to 3 pi over 8 for the angle. The next one would have 5 pi over 8, then 7 pi over 8, then 9 pi over 8, 11, 13, 15. When you get 17 pi over 8, that's the same thing as the original. So the 17 pi over 8 is 2 pi plus pi over 8. And then there's the topology, which was at the end of chapter 1. There were definitions there. I'm not going to have you state definitions. You might have to use the definitions for proofs, or you might have to identify things that on the exam from 4 years ago, there was a problem where I said, here's some sets. Identify these sets as open, closed, or neither. Connected or not, bounded or not, and domain or not. That's the nature of that question from 4 years ago. For each of the sets that were given. So there's no stating of definitions there, but you got to know the definitions well enough, from pictures at least, to be able to identify whether something is open, closed, or neither. Plenty of sets are neither open nor closed. Connected or not, domain or not, bounded or not, those are the main things to be able to identify. All right, I am going to try to start fresh in writing this exam. I'm not really going to look at the old exam. I am probably going to look at some of your completion problems and maybe pick a few of those to be problems that go on the exam, maybe slightly modified. Okay, so look over your completion problems, make sure you finish your journal too and get that right. I'm bringing it on Monday. See you then.